used to be called historically the heart of Asia. It has been the center of the ancient Silk Road, connecting Central Asia to South Asia and Middle East. Regional cooperation, in fact, is now one of the main five pillars of our foreign policy and an integral part of our development agenda. At the heart of this plan is the belief that private sector-led economic growth and strengthening regional economic cooperation will bring us closer, providing financial, socioeconomic, political, and security benefits for the entire region. Thus, we have faith that providing competitive opportunities for businesses to be in the lead of our regional cooperation initiative can provide incentives as well as a platform for our interests to converge. I would like to give a few examples of what we have been doing specifically in terms of promoting regional cooperation, specifically within the Central Asian context. For regional cooperation, the first element is connectivity. Afghanistan's trade and economic relation with Central Asia have rapidly been enhanced, particularly in the past few years. In fact, what we have achieved in terms of our relationship with Central Asia in the past few years is what we haven't been able to achieve in 117 years. We have now many cooperation agreements on expanding our trade and transit cooperation with our neighboring countries. And we plan on taking other major steps forward. Some of these projects, to be more specific, that I can name are in terms of the railroad. We have established 4 railroad connections with Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and Iran, and now there is one on the way with Pakistan. The Lapis-Lazuri Corridor is an agreement that allows Afghanistan to export its goods to the EU countries through the Central Asian region, namely Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey. The first consignment through this corridor arrived in Turkey on the first week of January 2019. Travel Report is another way that connects us to a seaport, given that we are a landlocked country. The trilateral agreement on Chabahar allows Afghanistan to boost its exports and imports with India and other countries in the region. With the opening of the Chabahar route, the country's exports will increase to $2 billion from currently $1 billion a year. The air corridor is another step that we have taken towards regional connectivity. Air cargo corridors are connecting domestic markets to the international market. Right now, we have 6 air corridors to India, Europe, Gulf countries, and other Asian countries. We have established a transparent custom process that supports and enables the goods movement to air corridors. The total amount of exports last year to air corridors from Afghanistan was 6,163 tons. The other aspect for regional cooperation, particularly in the context of Central Asia, is the movement and on transit of energy. In addition, that Afghanistan has developed a 5-year self-sufficiency energy plan with diversified focus on solar, wind, and power generation. We have also made great strides toward becoming a regional trade hub for energy. The Tapi gas pipeline that connects Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India will finally start to kick off in the current year. The electricity transmission line with a capacity of 500 megawatts between Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, and Pakistan has already started. Kasha 1000, as Ms. Curtis pointed to is another project that transmits 1,300 megawatts of power from Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan to Pakistan. In addition to that, we have signed a bilateral agreement just recently with Turkmenistan that will focus on areas of economic, cultural, and security cooperation. We have 25 cooperation agreements now signed with Uzbekistan. All of these agreements have provided opportunities in expanding trade and economic relations with the government of Uzbekistan. Business has tripled between Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan over the past 3 years. Another sector that Afghanistan is very much interested in its development for its self-reliance agenda is the mining sector. I have been informed by the USGS that Afghanistan is the only country in the world that they have worked in that have been assessed by the three main ways that they can assess its mineral capacity and resources, which is through airborne, gravity, and magnetic waves. And the entire geography of Afghanistan has been assessed by all three different measures. The finding or the conclusion is that Afghanistan is also one of the countries in the world that has the most diverse types of minerals that no other country in the world has. In fact, it was called the Mendeley's table by some experts. In order to be able to exploit that and to take advantage of this immense opportunity, we have incentivized exploration activities and that will result and provide opportunities for the company to take an interest and invest in the sector. We have also revised the mining law that is addressing one of the weaknesses of the previous law, and now the licensing could be done by two states. Last year, specifically last December, two US companies signed contracts on initiation of the initial stages of exploring gold and copper in Afghanistan. Another commodity that would be of importance in the context of our regional trade is agriculture. Agriculture sector is one of the key parts of our economy. Now we have factories for fruits and nuts, carpets, and in addition to agricultural products for marbles and gemstones that can provide support to process and package these goods for the urban markets. Afghanistan private sector has been working to bring products from the countryside to the cities in order to prepare to process these goods. In the agricultural sector, we may not have the best quantitative comparative advantage, but we certainly have great qualitative comparative advantage in the high quality products. Therefore, there is immense opportunities for companies to invest in packaging and processing agricultural products. However, all of these opportunities need an enabling environment to function and the incentive for the private sector to invest. In order to address that, we have started to bring regulatory reforms in 10 concerned areas specified by the World Bank for doing business or the doing business indicators. As a result, in 2018, Afghanistan got in the top of the 10 doing business indicators and improvers among 190 countries. Similarly, we have made significant legal reforms and introduced new bills such as the public-private partnership, new companies law, new insolvency law and new mining laws that provide ground and incentive for investment and doing business in Afghanistan. All of these bills are drafted based on international best practices. Afghanistan is not only a trade and transit hub, but also has the potential to be a data transmission hub. Therefore, the government has launched open access policy in 2016, which provides a non-discriminatory regulatory reform so that it provides the companies and individuals to have access for growing fiber optic networks. Now, given that there is all these good news and opportunities, I know some of you at least may have the question about security, or say, what about the security? So I would like to wrap up by acknowledging that the security situation is obviously an ongoing challenge. The Afghan government's key priority is to maintain safety of the country and its citizens, and also provide incentives for the businesses and share measures and guarantees for the businesses and investors to encourage them for investment. But we also know that the peace and the peace process that is that's an ongoing effort would mean absence of violence and a functioning economy to become a reality. This is why we believe that with our unprecedented human capital and our determination for becoming a self-reliant economy and a country with a self-reliant economy, peace is in the horizon. So let's get down to business and discuss this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Rahmani, for that. I thought it was a great overview.